Good morning.
Good morning.
How tall are you now, Nathan? Is this for you? No, who's singing? Who's singing? Is that for you? I just walked up and I'm like, whoa, that's for somebody a lot taller than me. Good morning. Welcome to worship on this Pentecost Sunday. Happy to have all of you here this morning. You will note that today we are celebrating a baptism. Ethan and Jacob McDonald. Many of you, especially if you ever went to East Bay, know Katie B, as she used to be known, and we'll be baptizing her twin sons today. So we're very excited to have that. Just a couple of announcements I'm going to highlight for you this morning before we begin. A reminder that we are still selling the church t-shirts. They are, the order forms are still out there. We'll be doing that this Sunday and next Sunday. And then we'll be turning the orders in so that we can hopefully get the shirts back before the kids go to camp this summer. So if you'd like a shirt, we've got long sleeve, short sleeve, we've got hoodie sweatshirts, we've got polos with or without pocket. Please make sure you get those ordered either this Sunday or next Sunday. Also, I'm still collecting names of graduates this year. I've gotten a few more added today. But if you have anyone in your family, either 8th grade, high school, college, anybody who's graduating, if you'd please let me know. Next Sunday, we're going to have an insert with those names and take a moment in the service to honor and those who are here, congratulate them. And then the last thing I have is for the prayer list, just a little update. This week, I was able to go over and visit with Dorothy. You may have remembered a couple weeks ago, we made the announcement that she'd been in the hospital. She is doing better. She's still quite weak, and they're doing physical therapy, but we had a really nice visit, and she was anxious to hear about all of you and share. For those of you who know her, her oldest grandson and his wife are expecting her first great-grandbaby, and that's what she said to me. My oldest grandson and his wife are expecting my first great-grandbaby. So she's very excited about that. Also, I was visiting with Tim Whitson. He had his back surgery on Thursday. It went very well, and in fact, so well, he was able to come home a day early, and he's back here in town. So Viola, thanks you for your prayers for him, and he's doing well. Again, long recovery, but it's going really well, and they got a lot more done in the surgery than they thought they'd be able to, so we're very thankful for that. I was able to go with Sarah and the family and sit with Joyce for a little while in her first chemo treatment. She's doing okay. We continue to keep her in our prayers as this journey begins for her. And then I would also like to note, you'll notice that we've been praying for quite a while for Judy Johnson. This is Kelly Keefe's mother. I went down Friday to be with the family for a while, and she did die Friday night. So there'll be a service Monday night at the Gibson City Funeral Home. We'll talk to Kelly and Stan or myself about information, 7 p.m., right, with visitation from 5 to 7. 5 to 7 beforehand at Lamb Young in Gibson. So we, of course, keep Kelly and Stan and her whole family in our prayers during this time. And I forgot that there's an additional name on the prayer list. Susan Andresen is how it's pronounced. That's Gary Kale's sister. She's been going through some testing, and Gary just asked if we would keep her in our prayers as they try to figure out what's going on. So are there any other announcements or additions to the prayer list? I'll turn it over to you for whatever you may have. Rick.
With that, do we have any other announcements? Yes.
It's been kind of a long road, and a lot of you have been participants, but we're going to have an open house for Jordan's graduation. announcements are on the board. If you'd like to take one home, you're welcome, but anyone from the congregation is welcome to stop out and say hi.
All right. Very good. Thank you. All right. Jordan's embarrassed. Very good. Do you have any other announcements this morning? All right, then we will begin our worship on this Pentecost Sunday with our brief order for confession and forgiveness. We worship as we're baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
Our service continues on the screen or on page 28 of your blue with one voice. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let's pray together the prayer of the day. God our Creator, the resurrection of your Son offers life to all the peoples on earth.
By your Holy Spirit, kindle in us the fire of your love, and power in our lives for service and our tongues for praise. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading this morning is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own language, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall see dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.'" Here ends the first reading. The psalm this morning is taken from Psalm 104, verses 24 through 34. Let's read this responsively by whole verse, or as you see it on the screen up here. "How manifold are your works, O Lord! In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures.
Yonder is the sea, great and wide, with its swarms too many to number, living things both tall and hairy.
There go the ships to and fro, and Leviathan, which you made for the sport of it.
All of them.
You give it to them, they gather it, you open your hand, and they are filled with good things.
When you hide your face, they are terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust.
You send forth your spirit, and they are created. And so you renew the face of the earth.
May the glory of the Lord endure forever. O Lord, rejoice in all your works.
You look at the earth and it trembles. You touch the mountains and they smoke.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will praise my God while I have my being.
May these words of mine please God. I will rejoice in the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Hallelujah.
And the second reading this morning is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 14 through 17. "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, 'Abba, Father,' it is that very Spirit bearing witness with the Spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him." Here ends the second reading.
Now I invite kids to come forward for a children's message. All right. Well, do I see what I have here? A balloon? All right. I'm going to let this balloon go, so watch out, okay? Are you ready? I'm going to let it go, see if you can catch it. No. Well, it's a balloon, right? Have to blow it up? All right. Well, let's see what we can do here. Whoa! Well, that was unexpected, wasn't it? Did you hear that sound?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was loud. That was powerful, right? So, that, well, we... What would have happened if I had blown it up and it hadn't popped and I had let it go? It would have gone all over the place, right? You wouldn't have been able to, you might have been able to catch it, but if so, it would just be if it randomly came to you or if you're really quick and able to chase it down. But you're not going to know where it's going to go, right?
Yeah.
All right? But what would make it go? What would be making it go? Okay, yeah, it makes me saying it's like wind, and you're saying the air flying out of it, right? That air has power, all right? Now, here's the thing. You can't see the air, right? But you can feel it when there's wind, right? And you can fly a kite, and yeah, it's fun, isn't it? As long as the wind's not blowing too hard, right? So that air has power. And even the power of this air came from what? Well, once what put it into the balloon? My breath, right? My breath put the air power in there. Well, today is a day called Pentecost. It's a day that we celebrate the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God that gives us the ability to trust that God loves us. Gives us the ability to talk about God, gives us the ability to do good things for other people. We can try to do all those things on our own, but the Holy Spirit is one that really gives us the ability and power. And it's like this power, like air, like breath, that we can't see. We can't see, but God moves through it and gives us that ability. And it can be unexpected, like the balloon you can let go, or like, well, you know a balloon... if you blow it up enough, will pop. I didn't think this one was going to pop that quickly. So that was unexpected. But that sound, it was the power of that air. So the Holy Spirit moves in these ways that we don't always know how it's going to go, but it gives us power, ability to do things for God, for other people, to care for people, to trust in God. And also, if you heard in the first lesson that was read, it talked about these people, these followers of Jesus, they were all together in a room. There was a sound like the rush of a mighty wind came into the room. And so that was the first thing, that air power. The word for spirit, even, in languages of the Bible, is the same as word for breath and wind. So that air power, it sounded like a rush of a mighty wind. And then it said there were things like tongues of fire sitting on their heads. I see some of you even looking at our candle here, our large candle. And like that also, there's power in that flame. And going to talk more about that and the other sermon about both of those things. But it's this power that God gives that helps us to trust in God and to do good things for God. And we don't know where it's going to go, what it's going to do, but... The amazing thing with Pentecost is the promise that is given to the church. It's given to all of us, and we'll pray with baptism this morning for the Holy Spirit to move in the lives of Ethan and Jacob, and all who've been baptized have had that prayer prayed on you for the Holy Spirit to move in your life. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that you send your Spirit so that all of us can be part of what you're doing, so that we know your good news and we trust how much you love us, and so that we can share that good news of how much you love all the world. Thank you, God, for your Holy Spirit. Amen. Holy Gospel according to John, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Philip said to Jesus, "Lord, show us the Father, and we'll be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe in me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, because he abides in you, and he will be in you." I've said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The day of Pentecost is one of my favorite days of the church year, and it should be. It is, in fact, one of the three major festivals of the church, along with Christmas and Easter. It celebrates a massive turning point, something new that is happening. Now, the day of Pentecost itself, it was already a festival for the Jewish people. It was a celebration of the wheat harvest, and also became a time when the giving of the law of Mount Sinai to Moses was also celebrated. But that was not a major festival, but it was a festival that already existed. But it's what happened during that festival, 50 days after Easter, 10 days after Jesus had ascended back to the Father, that makes Pentecost such a big deal. Because what we celebrate on Pentecost, as you know, is the coming of the Holy Spirit to the church. For the church. And the images of the Spirit can help us connect with what that's all about. And we've heard these images probably and seen them, but it helps. I just love to dig into them and just think about the way that it makes us think about the Spirit moving. In Acts 2, Luke describes how the Spirit came with wind and with flame to give the church the power to bring good news to the world. Now, I think that the power of wind is just a fascinating power. Thinking about the power of wind, it made me think of when I was probably about Lily's age, and my family was at a beach in North Carolina, and we went to one of these, you know, little beach shops, and we saw there some kites, stunt kites. This is the kind where there were three, they were just diamond kites, but they were all stacked together and held together. So you need a little bit of extra help to get it into the air. And then it had the two handles, and instead of just one string, two strings and two handles, and you pull on one of those, and it'll spin one way, and you pull the other, and it'll spin the other way, and you can make it do figure eights and all kinds of things. And it's fun. Of course, you know, you need some wind power to have a kite fly, but there's always pretty much a sea breeze at the beach, so we could use that endlessly. But as you would stand there and hold those things, sometimes with just a regular sea breeze, it would just pull you down the beach. And just you have to kind of lean back and hold into it, and then it'll pull you one step, and it'll pull you another step. And you find yourself working your way down, and you have to watch out that you're not going to get into where people are and have the kites crash on top of people. The power of that wind can move, you know, that person, just flying kites. You can think of many examples, I'm sure, of the power of wind. Things that even a relatively small wind can do. It's fascinating. And it's not that the way the wind works is a total mystery. I mean, ground and water heat up at different levels, and different parts of the earth heat up different ways, and the heat and the cool and the air flows and so on. But still, as much as we can try to explain and understand it, it's still fascinating that it moves and has this great power. It's a great image of a source of power that we can't see. And that is what the Holy Spirit is, a source of power we can't see. The other type of moving air is equally fascinating, maybe even more fascinating to me, and that is breath. Now, a person can have some control over their breathing, right? And I know I don't look like a runner. Yeah, I didn't look like a runner in high school, but more like it. But I did run cross country in high school, and I learned how to control my breath, to breathe in for 4 or 5 or 6 steps and breathe out for the same number of steps. Keep that slow, and you could actually run much more smoothly and not get tired nearly as quickly. You know, on the other hand, you can hold your breath, and you can practice that. I had a for some type of a merit badge in Boy Scouts time where we would practice what you would do if you needed to survive for a long time floating in water instead of treading water. You just hold your breath and just lay face down in the water, let yourself dangle, conserve your energy, and hold your breath. And you can go for quite a long time doing that using very little energy. We can hold our breath, or we can breathe slow, we can control our breath, but no one decides to breathe. Oh yeah, I'm going to breathe. If you're thinking about other things, you don't forget to breathe, right? It's something that happens. And if you decide not to breathe, to hold your breath, you can only do it for so long until your body kicks you into breathing again. Probably even if you fall unconscious, your body kicks you into breathing again. We don't decide intentionally to breathe or not to breathe, but it happens and it gives us life. Again, air has this invisible power which we can't live without. And so think about those disciples of Jesus. As I said, 10 days earlier, Jesus had ascended to the Father, and now they're hanging out here. Jesus had appeared to them at various times over the 40 days since Easter, but now he's gone, and he's not just appearing to them anymore. They're in a situation much more like us. And they know they're supposed to carry out Jesus' good news into all directions, everywhere into the earth, to bring healing to the nations, to bring goodness to all people. They know that they're supposed to do this. That's Just a little bit of a challenge, though, isn't it? Just a little bit of a high bar, high expectations. Take the good news of God in every direction. They'd seen great things in Jesus, including his resurrection. But they were still the same bunch of bumbling and stumbling regular people that they had been before and that we've heard about. How were they supposed to accomplish this mission that Jesus had given them? And then a sound like the rush of a mighty wind fills the house. Invisible power from God, like the wind and the spirit that hovered over the waters in creation, like the spirit and the breath that filled new life, as God gives life to all living things, like the spirit that inspired the prophets to speak God's words of challenge and of justice and of comfort. Now this same spirit of God comes on them to give them the power that they need to do God's work. And if this wind of the Spirit wasn't enough of a symbol of God's power, then there are the flames, tongues like a fire resting on each of the disciples' head. This is something that we probably have even a little harder time understanding. Seems like one of those things where you had to be there, and even then it's kind of hard to describe. But we can understand the meaning, the symbol of these flames. Because flames have power. Fire gives light. It gives heat. It is really also quite essential to life. But flames are never stationary. They're not just in one place. It's hard to even say exactly how they exist. They exist as energy and not really as anything that can be captured. You can have something that you burn like a candle or firewood or liquid or gas, fuel, but still the flame has kind of a life of its own. Of course, for the disciples, the experience of these tongues of fire was not that they were actually burning or being consumed as with some other kind of fuel, but in fact that they were not burning, not being consumed, like the burning bush that Moses had found on Mount Sinai. Here is just this energy that shows the presence of God and the power of God that is on them. And you think of the difference. Think of the difference from thinking of, you know, Moses only seeing this, and this is holy ground, to this coming upon all of these people, which, yes, they had followed Jesus, but yes, we know they were very normal people with very real frailties and failings. And now the Spirit of God comes on them to give them the power to do what God wants them to do. What happens next reveals that the Spirit of God is not just there to make the disciples feel special. Yay, we've got it. Look at me. I'm lit up like a candle. No, it's not just look at me or we've got it or we can control it. So the Spirit of God has come to give them a purpose and an ability to spread God's good news to the world. This is what the Spirit is for and why the Spirit is given to them. And so all of them began to speak about Jesus, and they're speaking in all kinds of languages. Again, I think you had to be there, but that we can imagine more. Now, these are real languages that people from all over the world. Rick, would you like to enumerate them? Okay. You're good? Been there, done that? All right. So people from all different places, speaking all different kinds of languages, they hear good news in their own languages. This is a miracle of the Holy Spirit. Doesn't seem to have lasted, even, that the people, those disciples, could just continue on speaking in those languages. We don't hear about that particularly after this point. It's impressive. But being impressive wasn't really the point. That's kind of a sidelight. The point is that God's good news is for everyone, for people from all over. And this is a foreshadowing of that. This is a symbol, a sign that God's word will go to all people, that it is for everyone, that there's no one to be left out of this goodness, and that God gives the power. to share the good news. Now, some people, I suppose people hearing languages that they didn't understand, when they weren't hearing their own language, they thought, all these babbling people, they must be drunk. And again, very human detail to the story. And Peter says, no, they're not drunk like you think. I understand why you think that, but it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. He explained to them the power of the Holy Spirit. Recalling the words of the prophet Joel about the Holy Spirit going to be given to people, to all people. Again, before this, you would think of maybe the prophets having the Spirit of God to speak God's word. And now Joel had said there'll be a time when everyone can prophesy, can have this connection, this power of God to speak God's word. Peter says that time is now. People are speaking with the power of God, with the word of God, because God has given God's Spirit. So Peter explained that, and then he told them more about Jesus. Peter, again, who had not been such a great witness before this, Peter, who never got it, who never understood what Jesus was trying to say, but Peter, now filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, preaches and tells the people about Jesus and who he was and what he was about. And after Peter's sermon, 3,000 people were baptized that day. Hey, we have two baptized today. So. 3,000 people were baptized that day. The power of the Holy Spirit working and moving. And that's why Pentecost is such a great occasion for baptism. I'm happy to celebrate these baptisms today. Pentecost is also a great time to think about baptism, because in baptism we pray for the Holy Spirit in the life of those who are baptized. And all of us who have been baptized, we have been anointed not just with water or oil, but with the promise of the Holy Spirit to work through your life. And the Holy Spirit has the power to do great things in you, to do great things in us, in the church, to do great things in Ethan and Jacob. The Holy Spirit works in us the gift of faith. It's the Spirit of God that lets us cling to and trust in this good news, that it really is for you, that it really is for me. The Holy Spirit gives us faith. And the Holy Spirit works in us to give us special gifts and special energy to do things for others in Jesus' name, to do things beyond what we might think we have the gifts for, beyond what we think we might have the energy for. The Spirit awakens in us. It gives us a calling. It gives us an ability to do things for God's purposes. And the Holy Spirit helps us to share God's good news in our words and in our actions. And the Holy Spirit prods us to do what is good and right for people. Even if it's not something that we feel like doing, but the Holy Spirit gives us that energy and that prompting and that ability to do it. And if you want to see the Holy Spirit in action, look for Christians who are taking risks to stand up for people whose voice isn't being considered important by other people. Because that is the power of God's Spirit at work, when things would push against you or stop you, but you're able to do something for someone else's sake. It's the power of God. And the Holy Spirit does new things, bringing people into the love of God, sending the church in unexpected directions. We see evidence of this throughout the book of Acts. Peter praying with the Ethiopian eunuch, who has always been excluded from worship in the temple, according to the law, but asks, what is to prevent me from being baptized? And Philip says, nothing. Or when Peter is sent to Cornelius, as we recently heard about, to a Roman centurion, who was an outsider, but is brought in. And in so many ways, the Spirit brings in new people, does new things that are unexpected. The Holy Spirit is God's power of light. to shine with the good news. The Holy Spirit is God's power of life that gives life for all people. It's an invisible power, and it's not for showing off. But the power of the Spirit is a power with a purpose, to bring life-changing good news to people who really need good news. And if you're anything like me, you know that you need that help to do what God has for you to do. It is beyond your ability to do it on your own. If it's not, you're a better person than me, but I think I know what the kind of calls that we have are and the kind of help that we need from the Spirit. We need the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is the help that we need. So as followers of Jesus and as baptized children of God, we are claimed by God. God says, you belong to me. You belong to me. So we're claimed by God, and we're sent by God. God says, I have work for you. Bring good news to the world around you. Because you have seen in Jesus that life is stronger than death. God claims us and God sends us. But God also gives us power for the mission. God gives us the Holy Spirit to help. And not just given to those original disciples, but given to you and to me and to all of us together. So thanks be to God for the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the church, for the world. Amen. Now we celebrate the sacrament of holy baptism. See you. All right. In baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father frees us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're born children of a fallen humanity. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are reborn children of God and made members of the church, the body of Christ. Living with Christ in the communion of the saints, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God. Called by the Holy Spirit, and trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have your children baptized into Christ? As you bring your children to receive the gift of baptism, you are trusted with responsibilities to live with them among God's faithful people, bring them to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, teach them the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, place in their hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture them in faith and prayer, so that your children may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others in the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help your children grow in Christian faith and life? Sponsors, do you promise to nurture these children in the Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit to help them live in the covenant of baptism and in communion with the church?
I do.
People of God, we promise to support Ethan and Jacob. Pray for them in their new life in Christ.
We do.
I ask you therefore to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, to reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God?
I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, who was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by the Word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. And through the sea, you led the people of Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you set us free from the power of sin and death and raised us up to live in you. Pour out your Holy Spirit, the power of your living word, that those who are here washed in the waters of baptism may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Ethan, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give your daughters and sons new birth, cleanse them from sin, and raise them to eternal life.
Amen.
Lord, sustain Ethan with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Lord, sustain Jacob with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Been sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Jacob, child of God, has been sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Let your light so shine for others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father. Now let's welcome the newly baptized.
We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us.
Of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let's welcome the newly baptized, Jacob and Ethan. And let's share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Says peace be with you.
Yeah, peace be with you. Bless you, by the way.
He's okay.
Sorry to hear about your mom.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Hi, kid.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good.
Walk away for now.
I couldn't hear you. I knew you graduated.
Yeah, there's going to be an open house the 4th of June out at the farm in the afternoon. And there's invites out
peace
on the floor.
Oh, okay.
Peace be with you. Pastor.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
We'd be tickled if you come out and have a piece of cake with you.
Yeah.
That would be good.
All right.
And Laurie are in Texas. If we walk up there, he'll get the idea.
Let's pray. Merciful God, we offer
with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now let's pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord, we pray for your church, that we may continue to be filled with life by your Holy Spirit, driven out into the world by the Spirit's power to bring goodness and reconciliation, and peace and hope and joy in our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, we pray for all who suffer from hunger, from disease, from oppression, from abuse or neglect, from disasters, for all who are in desperate need of help. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all who are in need of healing as we remember the needs of Martin, Irene, Dixie, Lee, Julia, Marilyn, Barb, Dorothy, Iona, Lori, Pat, Melissa, Herb, Tim, Pat, Pauline, Steve, Alex, Rosemary, Don, Betty, Tim, Bob, Joyce, Pam, Nancy, Susan, and Lynn, and all those who need healing, for whom we pray. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we give you thanks for all who have gone before, with whom we are still united by your grace, by your Spirit. Today we remember Judy and pray for her family. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we give you thanks for joy in life, and especially the joy of the baptisms of Ethan and Jacob. We celebrate that we are made part of your one body. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who rose beyond the bounds of death, and on this day, as he had promised, poured out your Spirit of life and power upon the chosen disciples. At this, the whole earth exults in boundless joy. And so, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymns. Good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit, that by this Holy Communion we may know the unity that we share with all of your people in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and
Might you stand as we receive the blessing of Christ's table. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.